Subscribe to LearnCab and hit the bell icon to get notified.
Friends, the next change in the chapter of tax invoice, credit notes and debit notes, documents in short. Friends, this change which is there, it is a very small change. It is there to promote digital payments. Friends, currently a supplier under GST law is under no obligation, that he has to provide digital payment facilities to his recipients. Let's suppose I am a supplier, my turnover is more than 500 crore rupees. Let's suppose I make all B2C supplies only. Now, I am under no obligation that I give digital payment facilities to my recipients. There's no such provision in the GST law that forces me that I have to give an option of digital payment facilities to my recipients. I could very well say that from all my recipients, I collect only cash. I do not provide them any digital payment facility. If I'm providing voluntarily, that is my wish. But there's no provision in force which is forcing me to provide a digital payment or an electronic payment facility to my recipients. Now, friends, this force has started to come. There's a section which has been introduced, section 31 capital A, which tells that the government would notify a class of registered persons. This section is not there for all the registered persons. The government would notify a class of registered persons, and these notified class of registered persons have to mandatorily provide to their recipients an option to make the consideration, to make the payment of the consideration via digital mode or electronic mode. Now, after that, if the recipient still wants to make cash payment, that is the recipient's wish. But from the supplier's end, his responsibility is there to give an option of electronic or digital payment facilities to their recipients. And of course, this is not available to all the registered suppliers. This provision, section 31A, will apply only to a class of registered persons. So now, friends, so far nobody has been notified. So far no notification has been issued in section 31A. So this section in reality is not being implemented as of today. But as and when the government would notify any class of registered persons under section 31A, they would have to mandatorily provide a digital payment facility option to their recipients. Let's have a quick look at the section. The government may, on the recommendations of council, prescribe a class of registered persons who shall provide prescribed modes of electronic payment to the recipient of supply of goods or services or both made by him, and give an option to such recipient to make the payment accordingly. So, supplier is mandated to give digital facility payment option. If the recipient wants, he can use it and make the payments through digital facility, but it is mandatory for the supplier to give an option of digital payment facility to its recipient. And this is of course not applicable to everyone. It is applicable only to a class of registered persons who are going to be prescribed by the government. Now, friends, there's a circular. Circular number 137/07/2020. It gives solutions, or it gives options in various scenarios where an advance is received for supply of services. Let's suppose I supply services to you. I supply services to you, but only on 100% payment of advance. So you have to make a payment of advance. Whatever is my fees, you have to make an advance payment to me today. Let's suppose after a week or after 10 days, I'm going to supply these services to you. So now, friends, the moment I receive an advance, since it is a supply of service, my time of supply has arisen and I have to pay GST on receipt of advance. Now, friends, when I'm paying GST on receipt of advance, and subsequently, let's assume the contract gets cancelled. The contract gets cancelled and I have to refund you the entire advance amount which you have paid to me. But what about the GST which I've already paid? Now, that GST which I've already paid, there are two things. Question number one, the GST which is being already paid, can this GST liability, which is now nullified because I have refunded the advance amount to you, can this be adjusted against any other tax liability which might arise because of the supplies which I make in future, not to you, to somebody else? Let's suppose I received advance from you. I paid GST on advance. Now our contract got cancelled. I have to refund you the entire amount. Now the GST which I have paid to the government, this tax which I've paid, can I adjust it against any other invoice, against any other GST liability which might arise because of my issuance of an invoice? Can I do that? Or the only option is that I have to go and apply for a refund. So the question is, can this tax which is paid on advance for an advance received against supply of services, can this tax which is paid in advance, can it be adjusted against any other liability? Or the question is, should only refund be applied of the taxes which have been paid? So now, friends, this circular discusses various scenarios. So scenario number one, advance is received for services. Invoice is raised. advance received for services, invoice raised, contract is cancelled without provision of service. So friends, the scenario is I receive an advance from you. I raise an invoice, but subsequently after I raise an invoice, the contract gets cancelled. That means I do not provide the services to you. Now friends, a moot question which arises is, under GST, can I raise an invoice even without supplying any services? Please follow the question carefully. Under GST, can I raise an invoice even without supplying any services? Because this scenario envisages this situation. I receive the advance, raise an invoice, do not provide the services, the contract gets cancelled. Which means that even before I supplied the services to you, I have raised an invoice. Is it permitted under GST law to raise an invoice even without supplying services? The answer is yes, friends. As regards as section 31 is concerned, what is the time limit for issuance of an invoice? For a supply of services, I can issue an invoice either before I supply the services or within the prescribed time limit after I supply the services. So therefore, the law is giving me an option to raise an invoice even before I supply the services. So friends, I receive an advance. Now, I issue an invoice directly. I do not give a receipt voucher. I straight away issue an invoice. Can I do that? Yes, section 31 permits me to do so. So therefore, friends, I receive an advance from you. Against that advance, I do not give you a receipt voucher. I raise an invoice and subsequently the contract gets cancelled without provision of service. So now I raise an invoice. I would have paid GST to the government. Now the contract got cancelled. The supply never crystallized. Now the question is, the GST which I have paid, can I adjust it against any other liability or can I go and apply for a refund? Now the next question which comes is, how will I adjust? If at all I can adjust, what is the mechanism for which is available with me to adjust that advance GST which I have paid against any other liability? So now friends, I could issue a credit note under section 34. Under section 34, against a tax invoice already issued. Please understand, credit notes and debit notes can be issued only and only if tax invoice is already issued. So against a tax invoice which is already issued, subsequently if no supplies are being made, of course I can issue a credit note under section 34. When I issue a credit note under section 34, that reduces my output tax liability. Let's suppose in this particular month, in the month of July, I received advance from you. Let's say it was 1 lakh rupees plus 18,000 rupees. Totaling, I received 1,18,000 rupees from you. Now against this 1,18,000 rupees, I issued an invoice, July month's liability on 20th of August, I have discharged this liability, issued an invoice, reported it in GSTR 1 as well, and through GSTR 3B, I paid a taxes of 18,000. Now let's say friends, in the month of August, somewhere in August 25, the contract gets cancelled. Now when the contract gets cancelled, Since I have already raised a tax invoice, I would issue a credit note. This credit note, I would be issuing it in the month of August. Now friends, when I'm going to file my returns for the tax period August, by issuing a credit note, I have reduced my output tax liability to the extent of 18,000. Now let's say friends, in the month of August, I have certain other output tax liabilities which is ranging to 36,000 rupees. I have certain other output tax liabilities for the tax period August. So that 36,000 rupees, I would reduce my output tax liability because of the credit note which I have issued, and I would pay only 18,000 rupees as the differential tax. So friends, here the position is, what is the mechanism which is available to adjust this taxes which is paid on receipt of advance and invoice which is issued? What is the mechanism which is available to adjust it against other output tax liabilities? This is available by issuing a credit note under section 34. So now friends, in simple terms, the question is, whenever I receive an advance, I issue an invoice, I do not render the service, the contract gets cancelled. Can I adjust this liability against any other liability? Which means, can I issue a credit note or should I necessarily go for a refund? So friends, this circular is trying to tell you that both these options are available. I can either issue a credit note under section 34 and adjust this GST paid on advance against any other output tax, or go and apply for a refund if this adjustment is not possible. So now friends, why can I issue a credit note under section 34? Because credit note can always be issued only against a tax invoice. Since I've already raised a tax invoice, I can very well issue a credit note since the supply has never crystallized. So therefore friends, both these options are available. I could either issue a credit note and adjust it against my other tax liabilities, or I could go and apply for a refund. Now friends, adjust against output tax liability, or if no liability, I may opt for a refund. Now friends, could you tell me a scenario when I would not, or I would not be in a position to adjust it against my output tax liability? I could give you an example. Let's suppose you're there in the state of Karnataka, I'm there in the state of Tamil Nadu. Fine. I receive an advance. Now this is my first supply which I'm expecting to crystallize in the state of Karnataka. You're in Karnataka, I'm in Tamil Nadu. I'm a service provider, you're a service recipient. You pay me 1,18,000 rupees GST in advance. I issue an invoice, I charge you IGST. Now friends, please understand my business model. In my business model, I do not have any interstate supplies. My business is such that all my supplies are only intrastate supply. This was the first interstate supply which I expected to happen. This was the first interstate supply which I was expecting it to happen. I received 1,18,000 rupees from you. 18,000 rupees I paid it as IGST. 18,000 rupees I paid it as IGST. Unfortunately, this contract got cancelled. Now I issue a credit note. Now I'm going to issue a credit note. And now by issuing a credit note also would contain IGST. Credit note would also contain IGST. Now friends, please understand, in the month of July, I paid 18,000 rupees IGST. Contract got cancelled in the month of August by a credit note which is being issued. I want to reduce my output tax liability to the extent of 18,000 rupees. So I am having minus 18,000 rupees liability in IGST. Now this minus 18,000 rupees IGST liability, it can very well, by issuing a credit note, I can very well adjust it against any other output tax liability. But that output tax also should be IGST only. That output tax liability should also be IGST only, against which I want to adjust this 18,000 rupees IGST liability. Now friends, since I've discussed the business model with you in this example, that I do not have any interstate supplies. All my supplies are only intrastate supplies. Now friends, in the month of August, let's say I'm having an output tax liability. But my output tax liability is, let's say, 18,000 CGST and 18,000 SGST. But whereas I am having an advance GST paid to the extent of 18,000 rupees in IGST. Now friends, can I adjust this 18,000 rupees advance IGST paid against the CGST and SGST liability? The answer is no. Friends, IGST can be set off against CGST and SGST, but that is only with respect to electronic credit ledger. This is not my credit amount. This is not my credit amount. This is the advance tax which I have paid on receipt of advance. The moment I received advance, my time of supply has occurred. I have paid IGST on advance. I have raised an invoice. I am issuing a credit note. I can adjust this, but I do not have any IGST liability. So friends, the option available with me, the only option would be I can go and apply for a refund of this 18,000 rupees. So friends, this is what it is trying to tell you. If it is possible, you issue the credit note and adjust it against any output tax liability if you are having any. And please understand, inter-head adjustments will not be possible in this, because this is not your credit amount. The second option is, if this is not possible, or if I do not want to adjust, I want a refund only, in that case, I can very well go and apply for a refund. Second scenario, advances received for services, receipt voucher issued. Now, friends, please understand, in the second scenario, I am not issuing an invoice. In the first example, I receive an advance amount. I do not give a receipt voucher. I straight away issued an invoice. That was the first scenario. Scenario number two, advance is received. I give you a receipt voucher. I give you a receipt voucher. Subsequently, the contract gets cancelled. Whatever amount I have received from you, I have to refund it to you. Whatever amount I have paid to the government because I received an advance from you. Now, what is the treatment which is possible for that? Two options, are they available? Can I adjust this against any other output tax liability by issuing a credit note is the first question, or I have to mandatorily go only for a refund. Now, before we answer to that question, let us answer this. Can I remain without issuing an invoice on receipt of advance? The answer is yes, friends, because as regards as issuance of invoice is concerned, according to section 31, after supplying services within the prescribed time limit, let's suppose within 30 days, if it is a normal service, within 30 days, I have got a time limit to issue an invoice. I'm very well taking the leverage of that time limit. I do not issue a tax invoice. I just give you a receipt voucher, which was asked by me, which was required from me under Section 31. I give you a receipt voucher. I do not issue an invoice. There's nothing wrong which I have done. So now friends, advances received. Advances received, receipt voucher issued, contract cancelled. How many options are available? Are there two options are available? That is, I can give a credit note and adjust this, whatever taxes which I have paid, I can adjust it against any other output tax liability, or refund is the only option. Now friends, please understand, if you carefully remember the wordings or recall the wordings of Section 34, credit notes can be issued under Section 34 only and only against a tax invoice. The wordings itself clearly tells you where a tax invoice has already been raised, either a credit note or a debit note could be issued. Now in this case, friends, since I have not issued a tax invoice, the only option which is available with me is going for a refund. Because if I want to adjust it against me any other output tax liability, I have to issue a credit note. But I cannot issue a credit note because tax invoice is not raised. So friends, here adjustment or refund. The only option is first I have to issue a refund voucher and then I have to apply for a refund of the taxes which I have already paid on receipt of advance. Subsequently, the supply did not get crystallized. So therefore, whatever amount of GST I have paid, I have to go and apply for a refund. Now, these two first two scenarios were with respect to services. Now, let's see in the case of goods. The scenario is goods are supplied, invoice is issued, goods are returned. Now friends, when the goods are supplied, can there be an option that I do not raise invoice at all? The answer is no. If at all the goods are supplied, invoice has to mandatorily be raised. Friends, as regards to Section 31 is concerned, it gives you a leverage only for supply of services. You supply services within 30 days or 45 days as the case, maybe you can issue an invoice. But as regards as goods is concerned, invoice has to be mandatorily raised, either before or at the time of removal of goods, or in case if the supply does not involve movement of goods, at the time or before the time of delivery of goods to the recipient or making the goods available to the recipient. So therefore, this could be, as regards as goods is concerned, there could be only one scenario. If the goods are supplied, invoice has to be issued. But in services, we have found that there were two scenarios: advance received, invoice issued, or advance received, invoice not issued, receipt voucher issued. But over here, as regards as goods are concerned, and in goods, even if I'm receiving advance, I am under no obligation to pay GST, because as regards the supply of goods is concerned, on receipt of advance, I am not required to pay GST. So therefore, we are not bringing in the advance concept in GST, because in the case of goods, even if I'm receiving advance, my time of supply has not arisen. So therefore, we are talking only about one scenario: goods supplied, invoice issued, goods returned. Now friends, in this case, since the supply eventually and effectively did not get crystallized, even though I've supplied the goods, those are returned back to me. So I've already paid a tax for a supply which eventually did not get crystallized. So what are the options which are available to me? Adjustment or refund. Friends, I know very well you can answer this. Now, adjustment is by issuing a credit note. Refund is I can go and apply for a refund. Can I issue a credit note? The answer is yes, because under Section 34, once a tax invoice has already been issued, and if the supply doesn't get crystallized or doesn't get materialized, I can very well issue a credit note. So when I'm saying I can issue a credit note, then it means that I can go for an adjustment. I can adjust this against any other output tax liability. However, if I do not have any other output tax liability, or I want a refund only from the government, then I can go and apply for a refund as well. So friends, now the summary which is there. In case of services, advances are received, yes. Invoice is also issued. Scenario number one, advance received, yes. Invoice issued, yes. Action required, I can issue a credit note. Refund or adjustment, anything is possible. I can either go for an adjustment of my output tax liability, or I can go and apply for a refund. Scenario number two, services, advances is received, invoice is issued. The answer is no. I did not issue an invoice. I have just given you a receipt voucher. Now, against this receipt voucher, what am I supposed to do? I am going to issue a refund voucher to you. Now, the taxes which I have already paid, can I go for adjustment as well as refund? The answer is no. It is only refund. Now, friends, supply of goods, Advances received, it could be anything, because it does not matter as regards as goods is concerned. Whether you receive advance or you do not receive advance, the time of supply is never linked to receipt of advance. Invoices issued, yes, we have supplied the goods and we have to necessarily issue an invoice. Action required, I have to issue a credit note. And post issuance of credit note, if I want, I can adjust it against my output tax liability, or if I do not have any output tax liability, I can go and apply for a refund. Now friends, if you look into this, as regards as scenario number one is concerned, I can either go for adjustment or go for a refund. Scenario number three is concerned, either I can go for an adjustment or I could go for a refund. But in scenario number two, that means against services, advances is received, receipt voucher is issued without issuing an invoice, my only option is to go for a refund, because I cannot issue a credit note, because credit notes can be issued only against tax invoices. Now friends, practically if we see, which one is easier? Whether adjusting against my output tax liability is easier or refund is easier? Friends, always adjustment against output tax liability is simpler, because refund would involve certain compliance work, it would require certain paperwork, you have to go to the department, you have to appoint a professional. But as regards as adjusting against any other output tax liability is concerned, you can straight away adjust it yourself in the periodical return itself. So refund would involve time, it would involve cost, it would involve compliance. So therefore, it is always better to adjust it against the output tax liability. So friends, practically what needs to be done? That let's suppose practically what needs to be done is, whenever you receive an advance, if you do not want, please understand, whenever you receive an advance and if you do not want to go and apply for a refund, you always want to make an adjustment against an output tax liability, immediately on receipt of advance, issue a tax invoice. Immediately on receipt of advance, rather than going for receipt voucher, issue a tax invoice. So can you issue a tax invoice? Yes, I can issue a tax invoice even before I am supplying the services according to Section 31. So the moment you issue a tax invoice, what happens is, subsequently, even if the contract gets cancelled, you have an option to give a credit note and adjust it against the output tax liability. Or if you want to go for a refund, you can still go for a refund. But if at all you're issuing a receipt voucher, the only option which is available with you will be that you have to go for a refund. You will not be in a position. You will not be in a position to adjust it against any other output tax liability, and going for a refund would involve additional cost and time. So it is always better to issue an invoice if your accounting practice supports this. Friends, the next step which the government has taken is to improve transparency in the system and to reduce corruption. Now friends, let's say many a times what happens is, the officer in order to harass the assessees, they issue a notice. They issue a notice to the assessees, and the assessees, they become scared, they come to the officer. They make the offer for some settlement, and the notice which was issued by the officer, the officer doesn't close it formally, the officer just tears the notice. It happens as though the notice was never issued. So in this way, in this mechanism, the officer was in a position to loot money from the genuine assessees. And it could happen otherwise also. Let's suppose the officer issues a notice. The officer issues a notice and it is a manual notice which is being issued. It is not sent to you through the portal. The manual notice is being issued, the assessee receives the notice. Now, since the assessee has received the notice and he knows that there's a tax evasion which is being done, he takes the notice to the officer, he offers for some settlement, and he tells that, please tear this notice, just treat it as though the notice was never issued at all. So now friends, in all these cases, that is wherever the communications which are coming from the officers, if they do not have a trial in the system, there is no audit trial for the communications which are sent by the administrative department to the assessees, there is high chances of corruptions which can be there, or the assessee along with the officer would collide and would loot the revenue of the government. So therefore, in this step, what the government has done is, all communications which comes from the department should necessarily bear an electronically generated document identification number. Any communication including emails, if it is coming to the assessee which doesn't bear a document identification number, that communication would be an invalid communication. Let's suppose you receive a notice from the department which doesn't have a document identification number. You are under no obligation to reply to the notice because that is an invalid document, as it does not contain document identification number. Now, what is the advantage, friends? This document identification number could be generated only online. So the government officer or the departmental officer has to log into the portal, and at the back end, he would be given access and he has to generate a document identification number. So each document identification number which is generated, just like that, he cannot close it. Let's suppose the officer issues a notice to you which is having a document identification number. Now, can the officer just tear the notice and treat it that the notice was never issued? The answer is no, because the system has got a trial that how did this notice which is bearing this DIN, how did it get closed? What were the response you have taken from the assessee? How much tax, interest or penalty did you collect? So all these audit trials would be available in case if there is a document identification number which is available. So now, friends, through this circular, the board has made mandatory that even email communications have to bear a DIN. Without DIN, the assessee is under no obligation to respond or to reply to those communications. So the board wide circular directs that electronically generated DIN shall be quoted in respect of all communications, including emails sent to the taxpayers and other concerned persons by any office of CBIC across the country. What are the advantages? As we have already discussed, this would create a digital directory for maintaining a proper audit trail of communications sent to the taxpayers and the other concerned persons. And it would provide the recipient of such communication a digital facility to ascertain the genuineness of the communication. That means whenever the recipient receives a notice which is bearing a document identification number, the recipient can go to the portal and he can check whether this DIN is genuine or not. If this DIN is genuine, that means there is going to be a central repository of the DINs which are being generated. He could authenticate the validity of the DIN, and if the DIN is genuine, which means the notice is also genuine. Now, validity and exceptions. Any communication which doesn't bear a DIN, except in the following circumstances, that communication would be treated as invalid. So, what are those circumstances where a communication would be valid even if the DIN is not present? That is when there are technical difficulties in generating the DIN. Maybe the system is not supporting currently to generate a DIN, or when the communication regarding investigation, inquiry, verification, etc. is required to be issued at short notice. It is required to be issued at short notice in urgent situations, and the authorized officer is outside the office to discharge his functions. He is not in a position to generate the DIN. So in these two scenarios, a communication can come even without a DIN. However, whenever these communications which are coming without the issuance of the DIN, let's suppose due to some technical difficulties or because the officer in urgent situation is not able to do that, he has to take post facto approval. That means in cases where the communication has gone without a DIN, after, as soon as the technical difficulties which were there while generating a DIN is resolved, or as soon as the officer is back into office, he has to mandatorily generate a DIN. So friends, in simple terms, DIN has to always come along with the communication. The communication must bear a document identification number. In exceptional circumstances, it may not bear when the communication is coming, but subsequently for even those communications, as soon as possible, the officer has to generate a DIN. Next, there is a welcome measure as regards as payment of taxes is concerned. Friends, let's take an example. Say, suppose the output tax liability for a registered person for a particular tax period, let's say is 18,000 CGST and 18,000 SGST. Input tax credit what he has got, let's say it is 9,000 CGST, 9,000 SGST. So therefore, the amount which is supposed to pay through his electronic cash ledger, is CGST 9,000, SGST 9,000. So in short, his total liability of 18,000 rupees is discharged 9,000 via credit ledger and 9,000 via cash ledger. So now what he is supposed to do, he has to go to the portal in create challan. He has to create a challan and deposit the amount 9,000 in CGST and 9,000 in SGST. Now let's say he goes to the portal, he goes to the challan, and in the challan he says 9,000 CGST and 9,000 SGST totaling to 18,000 rupees he pays off this challan. And only, friends, only after he is paying the challan he notices, that what he has deposited is 9,000 in CGST and 9,000 in IGST. Please understand, he was supposed to pay 9,000 in CGST and 9,000 in SGST, but in the flow he has deposited 9,000 in CGST and he thought the next would be SGST, but unfortunately the next one was IGST. So he deposits 9,000 rupees in IGST tax head. Now friends, if you carefully look the way in which the challan has been structured, it says CGST, IGST and CESS. That means all these three heads are first which goes to the central government. And then you have SGST. So then you have the amount which is going to go to the state government. So now friends, this person has deposited CGST 9000 and IGST 9000. Now the question is, his liability is CGST 9000 and SGST 9000. He has deposited 9000 in CGST and 9000 in IGST. Now that amount which is deposited in 9000 IGST, I repeat, that amount which is deposited in 9000 IGST, can he offset it against SGST liability? Friends, please understand, as regards his credit is concerned, IGST credit can be used against SGST. The answer is yes, IGST credit can be used against SGST. But as regards his cash ledger balance is concerned, there is no possibility of inter-head set-off. Amount which is available in IGST cash ledger can be used only for IGST. And furthermore, friends, amount which is available, let's say, in tax head of IGST. Amount which is available in tax head of IGST cannot be used, for paying interest liability of IGST. Please understand, inter-head is not allowed. As regards as cash ledger is concerned, inter-head set-off is not allowed. That means IGST cash cannot be used for payment of SGST liability, agreed. Even within IGST, if the amount is available, let's say in IGST tax, and you have to pay IGST interest. So the cash balance available in IGST tax cannot be used, to pay the interest IGST, the interest portion of IGST. So now friends, inter-head set-off is not allowed, and even within the head, setting off between minor heads also is not allowed. Setting off between minor heads, that is adjustment between minor heads, is also not allowed. So now friends, this case, this scenario, the only option was, that this person has to pay SGST separately, and whatever IGST wrongly which is available in the cash head of IGST, he can go and apply for a refund. And as we all know, refund would block your working capital because it would take time for this amount to realize. It would involve additional cost. It involves additional paperwork. So therefore, the assessees, and this mistakes happened across the country. The assessees were under huge distress, and they requested the government that you give us an option. Either you create a single wallet, you don't have separate wallets, you just have a single wallet wherein whatever amount I want to deposit, I will deposit it in that wallet, and therefrom I'll take it to the different heads and I would offset my liability. Either you do this or you allow us, let's suppose even if an amount is being paid under wrong minor head or wrong major head, you allow us to transfer the amount from one head to another head. So now friends, the government thought it that it would not be possible to create a single wallet because all the pockets of different governments are different and the government are having separate bank accounts. For IGST, there's a separate bank account which the government is having. CGST, there's a separate bank account. For SGST of different states, there's a separate bank account. So having a single wallet would not be possible. So what the government thought is, let us give an option in the portal itself wherein, the assessee can transfer the amount from one minor head to another minor head within the same major head, or the assessee can also transfer the amount from one major head to another major head. So therefore, it is also possible to transfer from IGST to SGST. Yes, it is possible to transfer within IGST itself. From tax to interest, it is possible for the assessee to transfer. So now the transfer can happen between any major heads, and between any minor heads the transfer is possible. And let's suppose the moment you're initiating a transfer in the portal that you want to transfer the amount, let's say in our example, from IGST to SGST, parallelly at the back end, the government would also transfer the amount from IGST's bank account to SGST's bank account. This would happen parallelly at the back end, which the government is supposed to do. And friends, the moment you're transferring the amount from one head to another head, in our example, the moment you're transferring the amount from IGST to SGST, it would be deemed that you have applied for a refund of IGST, and it would be parallelly deemed that you have deposited the amount in SGST head. I repeat, it is a deemed refund and deemed deposit provision. So this was there to enable the assessees to overcome the small mistakes which happened. So now friends, let's have a look at the provision. Section 49 subsection 10 tells you, a registered person may on the common portal transfer any amount of tax, interest, penalty, fee or any other amount available in the electronic cash ledger under this act. So we are reading section 49 of CGST Act. So the amount which is available under CGST Act to the electronic cash ledger for integrated tax. So from CGST you can transfer to IGST. Central tax, from CGST you can also transfer to CGST. Now why would a person want to transfer from CGST to CGST? It could be a case a person would like to transfer from CGST tax to CGST interest. So within one major head, shifting between minor heads, is it possible? The answer is yes, it is possible. So it tells you the amount which is available under the electronic cash ledger under this act can be transferred to the electronic cash ledger for integrated tax, central tax, state tax, union territory tax, or even cess in such form and manner and subject to such conditions and restrictions as may be prescribed, and such transfer shall deem to be a refund from the electronic cash ledger under this act. So friends, they have prescribed the mechanism. We are going to see in the rules. You have to file a form called as PMT09 and you can transfer the amount between heads. Where any amount has been transferred to the electronic cash ledger under this act, the same shall be deemed to be deposited in the said ledger. So friends, vice versa scenario, let's suppose from IGST you're transferring it to CGST. From IGST if you're transferring it to CGST, now the moment transfer is done, it would be deemed as though the amount is deposited in CGST itself. Section 53A. This is what is going to happen at the back end. This, as a registered person, the assessees are not concerned. This the portal has to take care at the back end. Where any amount has been transferred from the electronic cash ledger under this act, which is under CGST Act, to the electronic cash ledger under SGST Act or UTGST Act. So where a transfer is initiated from CGST to SGST or to UTGST, the government shall transfer to the state tax account or union territory tax account an amount equal to the amount transferred from electronic cash ledger in such manner and within such time as may be prescribed. So this would happen at the back end. We are not bothered about it. So whenever you transfer the amount from one head to another head, at the back end, the government would parallelly transfer those amounts from one bank account to another bank account. This provision is there in section 53A of the CGST Act. You also have a parallel provision in section 17A of the IGST Act. Now friends, please understand, whenever you are transferring the amount from IGST to SGST, whenever you are transferring an amount from IGST to SGST, at the back end, the government has to transfer the amount from IGST bank account to SGST bank account or to the Union Territory Tax bank account. So this is what section 17A of the IGST Act is telling you. Where any amount has been transferred from the electronic cash ledger under this act. So here this act is nothing but your IGST Act. To the electronic cash ledger under the SGST Act or the UTGST Act, the government shall transfer to the state tax account or union territory tax account an amount transferred from the electronic cash ledger within such manner and time as may be prescribed. So friends, in very simple terms, you can file a form called as PMT09 and transfer between major heads or transfer between minor heads. That is possible. Whenever you initiate a transfer, at the back end, the government would also transfer the money from one bank account to another bank account. Rule number 87, subrule 13, it tells you this transfer can be done by filing a form on the common portal called as form GST PMT09. So the moment you fill that from which minor head you have to transfer to which minor head, or from which major head you want to transfer to which major head, if you can fill this form in PMT09 and submit it, then immediately on submission of this forms, the amount stands transferred to the destination heads. Friends, the next amendment which is there, it is there to check the frauds which are happening in input tax credit. In order to appreciate the amendment which has come, we have to understand the real life scenario. In reality, how does input tax credit frauds happen? So friends, let us understand this with the help of an example. Let's say there are four players in a chain. There's one Mr. A who's GST registered person in the state of Maharashtra. Mr. B is also a GST registered person in the state of Uttar Pradesh. Mr. C, GST registered person in the state of Tamil Nadu. Mr. D is a GST registered person in the state of Karnataka. So now friends, as regards as their business model is concerned, Mr. A is a dummy person. That means his GST registration is taken only to defraud the government. He doesn't have any real purchases, any real sales. Physically or financially doesn't do any purchases or any sales. He just issues sales invoices. He's only issuing sales invoices. There is no underlying goods which are going along with those sales invoices. As regards as Mr. B is concerned, he receives dummy purchase invoices from Mr. A and he further supplies dummy sale invoices He further gives dummy sales invoices to Mr. C. So Mr. B is also a bill trader. There are no underlying goods which are moving. He just receives fake invoices from Mr. A and gives fake sale invoices to Mr. C. Now friends, Mr. C is the most important person in the chain. Now as regards as Mr. C is concerned, he is having real sales. Please understand, he is having real sales and real purchases. He is having purchases also, he is having sales also, and there are underlying goods which are there. But please remember, Mr. C is purchasing the goods without any invoice. His purchases are without the cover of an invoice. Mr. C purchases the goods without the cover of an invoice. But however, when he wants to sell the goods, his customer Mr. D in the chain, he is a real person. Mr. D is a real person in the chain. Now when Mr. C wants to sell these goods, please understand, Mr. C is physically purchasing the goods and selling the goods. At the sale point, that is his customer Mr. D, he is a genuine person. He would purchase the goods only with the cover of an invoice. So now Mr. C, who is there in the chain, he has to issue a sale invoice to Mr. D. However, at the purchase point, Mr. C would have purchased some goods from the third person. Mr. C has purchased the goods without an invoice. I repeat again, Mr. C has purchased the goods without an invoice, but he can sell the goods only with the cover of an invoice because his customer Mr. D is a genuine person. He requires the goods, he also requires the invoice. So now friends, as regards as the business model of C is concerned, physically is purchasing the goods, but is purchasing them without an invoice. And he is selling the goods, with an invoice. So now friends, naturally, if you're raising a sale invoice parallelly at your purchase end, you do require a purchase invoice. Otherwise, his fraud would be shown to the government. So therefore friends, please understand or visualize the scenario of Mr. C. Mr. C has got purchases. His purchases are real. Physically goods he is purchasing, but he is purchasing the goods without invoice. Maybe it is coming for a cheaper rate. Maybe he wants to save the taxes. He is purchasing the goods without an invoice, but at his sale point, he has to sell these goods and he has to raise an invoice. So now friends, what is missing? Physically he purchases the goods. Physically he sells the goods. When he is selling the goods, he has to raise a sale invoice, but at his purchase point, he doesn't have a purchase invoice. So what he does, he enters into an agreement with Mr. B of Uttar Pradesh just to provide him a dummy purchase bill. Mr. B would raise a sale invoice on Mr. C. This would become the purchase invoice of Mr. C. So now friends, as regards as Mr. C is concerned, he is a dummy come real person. Now friends, as regards as Mr. C, it is very important for you to understand the role of Mr. C in the chain, because it is from here where the credit which was fraudulent so far will get converted into real credit. So now friends, as regards as Mr. C is concerned, physically he purchases the goods? Yes. Does he purchase them without invoice? No. Physically, does he sell the goods? Yes. Does he sell them with an invoice? Yes. Does he require a purchase invoice? The answer is yes. Because since he has raised a sale invoice, he has to have a purchase invoice. So he enters into a transaction, a contract, a collusion with Mr. B and tells Mr. B that you just give me an invoice. Don't give the goods. Goods already I'm having it with me. So Mr. B would give the invoice alone to Mr. C. Mr. B would give the invoice alone to Mr. C. So now friends, Mr. C is dummy come real person. Now you may wonder, what would Mr. B get? What would Mr. B get by just giving an invoice to Mr. C? Please understand, by giving an invoice to Mr. C, there is a credit worth of 18,000 rupees. Mr. C would pay him some commission of say 5%. He would pay him 5,000 rupees and have a purchase invoice. He would buy a purchase invoice worth 1,18,000 rupees, wherein the credit involved is 18,000 rupees. Then it goes to Mr. D. Now as regards as Mr. D is concerned, his purchase is also genuine. He is having a purchase invoice. He is having the goods which are underlying in that purchase invoice. His sales are also genuine. Let's say he is selling to an end consumer. Let's say Mr. D of Karnataka, he sells to an end consumer. Now friends, I repeat again, it is very, very important for you to understand the modality, the business models of Mr. A, B, C and D, so that we'll be able to appreciate this example in a much better manner. I repeat again, Mr. A, dummy purchases, dummy sales. Mr. B, dummy purchases, dummy sales. When I say dummy purchases and dummy sales, it means there are no underlying goods. which are moving. It is purely and purely bill trading. Mr. C physically is purchasing the goods, but the place from where he is purchasing the goods, from that place he is not getting any invoice. He is physically selling the goods, his customer wants an invoice. So what is missing is, he is having the physical goods inwards and physical goods outwards. He is having an invoice, he raises an invoice and gives it to Mr. D. But however, he doesn't have a purchase invoice, and without having a purchase invoice, he cannot finalize his accounts. So therefore, now friends, Mr. C gets a purchase invoice. He buys an invoice from Mr. B by paying some commission. And Mr. D in the chain, he's a genuine person. He purchases goods, he sells goods. Both are with the cover of an invoice and it goes to the end consumer. Now friends, let's analyze. Now as regards as Mr. A is concerned, he's a GST registered person. Yes, he has to file his GST returns. He has to file GST R1, he has to file GST R3B. So now friends, Mr. A would say, while he's filing his GST R3B, he would say, my output tax is 18,000 rupees. My input tax credit is also 18,000 rupees. Now friends, this input tax credit which Mr. A is claiming, it is a fraudulent input tax credit because he doesn't have any purchase invoice. He doesn't have any goods which is coming to him. It is merely just puts an entry in GST R3B stating that my input tax credit is 18,000 rupees. There's no invoice and there are no goods which have been received by him. Will the portal accept it? The answer is yes. Whatever junk you punch it in GST R3B, it would accept it. So he tells in his GST R3B, my output tax is 18,000, input tax credit is 18,000, doesn't pay anything to the government in cash. So now friends, let's pose few questions against Mr. A. Has Mr. A received any goods? The answer is no. Has he received any purchase invoice? The answer is again no, because in GST R3B, simply putting in 18,000 rupees is my credit, he doesn't have an invoice. He doesn't have the goods underlying. Does anything appear in his GST R2A? The answer is no. In his GST R2A, nothing appears because there is no purchase invoice which he has received from anyone. He is the person who is giving birth to a dummy credit. In this entire chain, Mr. A is a person who gives birth to dummy credit. So there is nothing which is coming in GST R2A because he has not received any invoice. He has not received any goods from any person. So is anything appearing in his GST R2A? The answer is no. Next one, are his purchases real? The answer is no. His purchases are not real. There's no purchase at all, in fact. Are his sales real? The answer is no. There is no sale at all. He just gives an invoice to Mr. B. Is he eligible for input tax credit? The answer is clear cut no. It is a fraudulent input tax credit. It is a fraudulent input tax credit. He has given birth to a dummy credit. Now friends, what returns would Mr. A file? Mr. A would file GST R1 and GST R3B. In GST R3B, he tells my output tax 18,000, input tax 18,000, pays 0 rupees to the government in cash. In GST R1, he would say, I have made a B2B supplies to Mr. B. In GST R1, he would say, this is the invoice number, this is the invoice date, this is the GSTIN of Mr. B, 1 lakh rupees is the value and 18,000 rupees is the tax. So much of amount is what he has raised an invoice to Mr. B. So now friends, coming to Mr. B. As regards as Mr. B is concerned, he has got a purchase invoice. Yes, Mr. A has given him an invoice, that becomes his purchase invoice. He further raises a sale invoice upon Mr. C. Why does Mr. C require an invoice? Because Mr. C has got goods but not invoice. Please understand, Mr. C has got goods but not the invoice. So therefore, now Mr. B has received a purchase invoice from Mr. A and he in turn raises a sale invoice on Mr. C. So now friends, as regards the calculations of Mr. B is concerned, his output tax is how much? 18,000. How much is his input tax credit? 18,000 rupees. How much does it pay to the government in cash? It is zero. Now friends, let's pose few questions against Mr. B. As regards as Mr. B is concerned, did he receive any goods? The answer is no. He has not received any goods. The next question, has Mr. B received an invoice? The answer is yes. He has received a purchase invoice from Mr. A. Whether anything appearing in his GST R2A, the answer is yes, it is appearing in his GST R2A. Mr. A of Maharashtra would file his GST R1 against Mr. B, uploading that particular invoice. That would appear in his GST R2A of Mr. B. Are the purchases real? The answer is no. There are no physical movement of any goods which is happening. There are no underlying goods which are moving. Purchases are not real. The sale also is not real because he merely receives the purchase invoice and raises a sale invoice upon Mr. C. Whether ITC is eligible to him? The answer is again no. ITC is ineligible. It is a fraudulent input tax credit. It is not eligible because, please understand, the conditions for taking input tax credit, you should receive the goods. Has Mr. B received any goods or supplying any goods? The answer is no. It is a fraudulent input tax credit. Now friends, come to the chain of Mr. C. Let us understand his scenario. As regards as Mr. C is concerned, his output tax is 18,000. He raises an invoice upon Mr. D. His input tax credit is also 18,000. He receives a purchase invoice from Mr. B. He pays 0 rupees in cash to the government. Now let's pose few questions against Mr. C. As regards as Mr. C is concerned, is there any goods which he has received? Now friends, please understand, Mr. C has received some goods, agreed, because he is making, physically is purchasing goods and selling the goods. But has he received any goods from Mr. B? From whom he has received the purchase invoice? The answer is no. Now friends, please understand, he has received the goods, but those goods which he has received was without the cover of an invoice. He made purchases of goods without invoice. Now he is receiving an invoice from Mr. B. From Mr. B, is he receiving any goods? The answer is no. Because the reason why I am questioning is this, because from Mr. B, he received an invoice. Against that invoice, he is going to take the credit. But against that invoice, has he received any goods? The answer is no. Against the invoice against which he is going to take the credit, he has not received any goods. So he has not received any goods. Has he received an invoice? The answer is yes. He has received a GST invoice from Mr. B. Will it appear in his GSTR 2A? The answer is yes. Mr. B would also file his GSTR 1. He would also file his GSTR 3B. When Mr. B files his GSTR 1, that particular invoice will get auto-populated in GSTR 2A of Mr. C. Are the purchases real? Now friends, these purchases are not real. When I say are the purchases real, he has physically purchased the goods, but those goods he has purchased were not with the cover of an invoice. Now against the invoice against which he is claiming the credit, that particular invoice of Mr. B against which he is claiming the credit, against that purchase invoice, there is no particular purchase. There are no underlying goods which has happened. So against that particular invoice, the purchases are not real. Are the sales real? The answer is yes. Here friends, the sales is real. Here is the place where the conversion is happening. Are the sales real? The answer is yes. He makes a sale invoice to Mr. D. He gives him the particular goods which are underlying with that particular invoice. His sales are real. Now friends, whether ITC is whatever input tax credit which he has claimed in his GSTR 3B, in his electronic credit ledger, whether that is eligible, the answer is no. The answer is no because, friends, please understand, he is having goods, he is selling them, but has he received any goods under the cover of the particular invoice against which he is taking input tax credit? The answer is no. He has purchased goods separately, he has purchased a purchase invoice separately. So friends, for him also, input tax credit is ineligible inside the chain. Now friends, coming to Mr. D, as regards as Mr. D is concerned, he has purchased goods from Mr. C and Mr. C has also given him an invoice. He is selling the goods to an end customer. He would raise a sale invoice on the end customer. He would say sales is 1,10,000 rupees. He is a real value addition who is doing real financial value addition in the chain. He raises a sale invoice upon the end user, 1,10,000, GST 19,200, totaling to 1,19,200. Now friends, his calculations, his output tax is 19,200. His input tax credit is 18,000 rupees. 1,200 rupees he pays in cash to the government. He pays it to the government through his electronic cash ledger. Now friends, let's pose the same questions against Mr. D. Did he receive the goods? The answer is yes. He has received the goods against that particular invoice only in which he is taking the credit. Has he got a purchase invoice? The answer is yes, he has got a purchase invoice. Does anything appear in his GSTR 2A? The answer is yes. Mr. C would file his GSTR 1. He would file his GSTR 3B. Whatever Mr. C is filing in his GSTR 1 would auto-populate in GSTR 2A of Mr. D. Are the purchases real? The answer is yes. As regards as Mr. D is concerned, his purchases are real. He purchases the goods also from the same person, Mr. C, and those goods are also coming with the cover of an invoice. Mr. D in this chain is not aware of this transaction that Mr. C, Mr. B and Mr. A are fraudulent persons. So are the purchases real? The answer is yes, the purchase is real. Now as regards as sale is concerned, is the sale real of Mr. D? The answer is yes, sale is also real to Mr. D. Now whether input tax credit is eligible for Mr. D? The answer is yes, he has received the goods, he has received the invoice. All the conditions of section 16, Mr. D is satisfying. Input tax credit is eligible to Mr. D. Now friends, here ends the chain. The goods go to the end consumer. Now friends, who is the loser in this entire chain? If you carefully analyze the chain, how much has the customer paid the taxes? The customer has paid the taxes to the extent of 19,200 because this is what Mr. D is raising to the end user. Customer pays the taxes to the extent of 19,200. Now friends, as we know, GST is a value addition tax. Value is being added at various stages in the entire supply chain. Now, if the customer is paying 19,200 tax to the supplier, Mr. D, how much should the government get the tax? The government also at the end of the day, in various stages of the chain, if it gets accumulated, the government should get a tax of 19,200 rupees, which is going to be from various stages in the chain. But friends, how much has the government got the tax in cash in this entire chain? The government gets a tax of only 1,200 rupees. The government gets a tax of only 1,200 rupees in this entire chain, whereas goods worth 1,10,000 rupees have been supplied. 19,200 rupees worth of tax has been collected from the customer. So now friends, this 1,200 rupees is a loss. This 1,200 rupees is what the government has received. 18,000 rupees is a loss to the government. 18,000 rupees is a loss to the government. Now friends, how does the government find it out? Of course, one day the government will find it out, but how? Now friends, please understand, when the portal would carry out an audit or when the department would carry out an audit of the returns of Mr. A. Now friends, please understand, as regards as Mr. A's returns are concerned, what is the data which is there in Mr. A's returns? As regards as Mr. A's returns is concerned, he has taken a credit of 18,000 rupees in his GSTR 3B, but in his GSTR 2A, it is zero. In his GSTR 2A, what has come is zero. Of course, he has not complied with the provisions of 36 sub rule 4, where you can take credit only to the extent of 110% of what is appearing in GSTR 2A. What appears in his GSTR 2A is zero. So therefore, it is clearly known to the government that this person is a fraudulent person because in his GSTR 2A, nothing is appearing. However, in his GSTR 3B, he has taken the credit to the extent of 18,000 rupees. Will the system allow so? The answer is yes. Friends, please remember our discussion in Rule 36 sub Rule 4. Whether system automatically calculates 36 sub Rule 4, the answer is no. You have to manually calculate it. Had it been automated that whatever is appearing in GSTR 2A, 110% of that will be restricted in GSTR 3B. The portal itself would restrict that credit. Here, it is not so. The portal on its automated motion doesn't calculate or restrict the credit complying the provisions of 36 sub rule 4. This has to be punched in manually. Even in your GSTR 2A, if the credit is zero and you punch 1 crore rupees in GSTR 3B, the system would still accept it. However, at the back end, it would do the reconciliation and give the data to the officer saying that in his GSTR 2A, it is zero. What he has claimed in GSTR 3B is 18,000 rupees, but that process would take certain time. Since it is not automated, it doesn't happen on a real-time basis, it would take certain time. Within that time, these persons will take leverage of that time and they would loot the government. So now friends, the government analyzes the data of Mr. A and it finds out that in its GSTR 2A, the credit is zero. But however, this gentleman has taken 18,000 rupees credit in his GSTR 3B. Now the government issues a notice. The government issues a notice to Mr. A. Now friends, as we all know, the first step would be to issue a show cause notice. The government issues a show cause notice to Mr. A. Now, the moment Mr. A receives the show cause notice, he vanishes off. Since he is a clear-cut fraudulent person, he is the person who is giving birth to dummy input tax credit. He vanishes off, he closes the... He doesn't have any place of business because he doesn't want a plane of business. There are no physical movement of goods which is happening. He just wants a system from where he could create GST credits by punching dummy figures in GSTR 3B. So now friends, when the government visits his place, whatever place he has given while he has applied for registration, the government visits his place of business, the department officials visit his place of business and find out that there's no such person who's operating from here. It is a dummy registration which is taken. Now, can you recollect why is Aadhaar authentication required? And in absence of Aadhaar authentication, why is physical inspection of the person and the place required? The amendment which has come in, the answer is yes. That is the reason why 25(6)(a)(6)(b)(6)(c) has been introduced. That even the existing registered person or the new registrations have to authenticate themselves by authenticating their Aadhaar number. And in absence of that, that means if a person doesn't possess an Aadhaar number, he has to get his premises physically verified in his own presence. So now friends, the story, let us continue. When the government goes and visits the place of business of Mr. A, it finds out that there is no such place of business. There's no such person who is operating from the said place of business. So now the government analyzes the data, it sees to whom, now the government is very clear that this person is a fraudulent person. Now it goes into the chain and sees, the government knows that this credit is going to continue into the multiple places of, into the multiple stages of the chain. And friends, please understand the modus operandi, how they are operating. How they are operating is Mr. A has taken a dummy registration in the state of Maharashtra. Mr. B has taken a dummy registration in the state of Uttar Pradesh. Both of them are in collusion, they are looting the government. But why have they taken registration in separate states? Friends, please understand the jurisdiction is different. Now the officer who is investigating the case of Mr. A would be different from the jurisdictional officer of Mr. B. And the information when it is being exchanged between two different officers, there's further time which is being wasted. And this time these people take advantage of. So now friends, as regards as these operations are concerned, they would operate across cross jurisdictions. Mr. A would be in Maharashtra, Mr. B would be in Uttar Pradesh, Mr. C is in Tamil Nadu. So now friends, when the officers are different across different jurisdictions, these people get more time. Now friends, the officer who is investigating Mr. A, he cannot investigate Mr. B because Mr. B is in Uttar Pradesh. His jurisdictional officer is different. Physically also the person is located in a different place. So therefore friends, now the information would be exchanged. The information would be exchanged by the officer, proper officer of Maharashtra's jurisdiction to the proper officer of Uttar Pradesh jurisdiction stating that there is an input tax credit fraud racket which is there, which is looting the government. So now friends, when the information goes on to the jurisdictional officer of Mr. B in Uttar Pradesh, now that person would give him a show cause notice because whatever is the investigation which has to happen, it has to happen along with the notice. Now friends, the moment Mr. B gets a show cause notice, what he would do? He would also try to run away because he is also a dummy person. And friends, but before he running away, what he would do is whatever credit he's having in his electronic credit ledger, he would pass it on to Mr. C. He would pass it on to Mr. C. Now friends, this credit, whatever invoices which he wants to raise, since he received the notice, now he comes to know that the government has known that this racket is existing. So therefore, as soon as possible, he would want to pass on all the credits which is there to different persons. So now friends, when the credit is being passed on to different persons, here the fraud is still continuing. The time which the government is going to take, since the credit is being passed on to different persons, the government has to investigate different persons. The time is prolonging and it is causing a serious irritation to the officer. The officers are being harassed. So now friends, what is the solution which the government has got? The government, what it should do is, the officers, what it should do is, the moment it knows that there is a racket which is operating, it should straight away stop those persons from utilizing their credits. Let's suppose the government finds out Mr. A and it takes the data that Mr. A has raised an invoice to Mr. B, Mr. B has raised an invoice to Mr. C. So the government should immediately block debiting the electronic credit ledger of Mr. B and Mr. C. The government should immediately block Mr. B and Mr. C from utilizing their electronic credit ledger. You want to raise an invoice, you want to pay the taxes, you pay it through electronic cash ledger. I would not allow you to utilize your electronic credit ledger. The moment the government gets to know that Mr. A is a fraud, immediately what it should do, it should find out the entire chain. Mr. A raises an invoice to whom, Mr. B raises an invoice to whom. Eventually it should find out, and all these persons who are involved in the chain, the officer should immediately block the credits, should immediately prevent these persons from utilizing their input tax credit, because it is the input tax credit through which these persons are defrauding the government. But friends, is there any provision in law? Is there any provision in law where the officer can straight away block the credit in the electronic credit ledger of a registered person? The answer is no. Straight away blocking is not possible. So what needs to be done is show cause notice should be given stating that you have in our come and show cause the reasons why we should not recover this credit from you, because this credit has been obtained fraudulently. So there would be a show cause notice, there would be representations, there would be a demand order, and during this time, till such time, see, the entire game is of time only, because Mr. A knows that one day government would find it out, and till such time he would play the game. Now friends, the entire game is of time only. The government doesn't want to lose this crucial time and prolong its investigation and to arrest these persons and put them behind the bars. Friends, so if the government follows the routine mechanism of giving a show cause notice, representations, order, then recovery, this prolongs the time of the government. So therefore, an amendment was being made, amendment was required, wherein the government gets the power that no show cause notice, no informing to these persons, straight away block their electronic credit ledger. They cannot pass on the credit to another person by utilizing their electronic credit ledger. So friends, since that provision was not there in law, that the officer has got the powers to prevent a person from utilizing his electronic credit ledger. Now that provision has come in, there is a rule called as Rule 86A, which is being inserted. Now with this background, let us understand and let us read the provision Rule 86A. And friends, are these cases happening for real? The answer is no. Whatever I've told you is not a story. You can just Google it out. If you say GST frauds, if you just go to Google and say GST frauds, there would be so many cases of fraud which the government is finding it out. Say for example, tax department cracks down GST frauds worth 7,896 crores. GST fraud, the government detects 931 GST fraud cases. GST fake invoices more than double in a year. So friends, all these cases are genuine. People are taking advantage of the system which is there, that whatever you punch in GSTR3B, the portal accepts it and credit can be passed on. Until the time the government is able to find it out, the credit goes on into the chain, and at the end there is going to be a genuine person who is going to get caught. In our chain, Mr. D happens to be a genuine person. Mr. A, Mr. B and Mr. C, they vanish off from the chain. Since they already have taken dummy registration, they would have taken registration impersonating someone. Some person in some village would have been there. In his PAN number, Mr. A would have taken a GST registration number. Now friends, Mr. A is different and the person who is registered is a different. The person who is registered is not even aware that there is a GST number which is running in his name. So these kinds of frauds and rackets are happening. So now friends, Rule 86A coming back. The commissioner or an officer who is authorized by him. I'm sure you're able to understand the objective, what the government wants. The government wants, without show cause notice, without any appearance, without any hearing, first block the credit ledger of that person. Stop him from utilizing the electronic credit ledger so that the chain of fraud credits is stopped. So friends, the commissioner or an officer who is authorized by him in this behalf, not below the rank of an assistant commissioner, having reasons to believe that. So the officer should have reasons to believe that credit of input tax available in electronic credit ledger has been fraudulently availed or it is ineligible. So friends, whenever an officer finds out that in this electronic credit ledger, the credit is either fraudulently availed or it is ineligible, who should be that an officer? He should be an officer who is authorized by the commissioner or the commissioner himself, and that officer should not be below the rank of an assistant commissioner. They should have reasons to believe. Now friends, what do you mean by reasons to believe? Should they have a proof? The answer is no. If they have a reason to believe that yes, this credit could be fraud, they can straight away block it. So let's read this further. A commissioner or an officer who is authorized by him in his behalf, not below the rank of an assistant commissioner, having reasons to believe that credit of input tax available in the electronic credit ledger has been fraudulently availed or it is ineligible in as much as. The credit of input tax has been availed on the strength of a tax invoice or debit notes or any other document which is prescribed under Rule 36. That means this credit is availed on the strength of some document which is issued by a registered person who has been found non-existent or not to be conducting any business from any place for which registration has been obtained. So friends, this credit has been availed on the strength of a document. The supplier of this document is not operating from the said place of business or is not existing at all. Or without receipt of goods or services. Credit has been availed on the strength of a document, but goods or services has not been received underlying this document. On with reference to this document, there are no goods or no services which have been received. So friends, this credit could be fraudulent or ineligible. Yes, this credit could also be fraudulent or ineligible. Friends, please understand, if the officer finds out that there are two reasons, either the credit is fraudulently availed or the credit is ineligible. In either of these two reasons, if the proper officer has reasons to believe, what he can do, we'll be seeing that later. But as of now, just understand, if the proper officer has reasons to believe that the following things has happened. B. The credit of input tax has been availed on the strength of a tax invoice or debit note or any other document prescribed under Rule 36 in respect of any supply, the tax charged in respect of which has not been paid to the government. So now friends, if at all you are having any input tax credit, if at all you have availed any input tax credit on the strength of a document against which the supplier has not paid the taxes to the government, the supplier has not paid the taxes to the government, here also the proper officer can block you from utilizing your input tax credit. Now friends, as regards as this provision is concerned, in my view, it is little harsh because here the government is open to block the electronic credit ledger of any person. Friends, please understand, here it tells you whether the credit is availed fraudulently or the credit is ineligible. In both the cases, the government can block your electronic credit ledger. Now friends, whether ineligible credit should always be fraudulent, the answer is no. Ineligible credit need not always be fraudulent. Say for example, I make a purchase from my supplier, the goods I have received, the invoice I have received, I have made a payment to my supplier. The invoice value entirely I have made a payment to my supplier. The supplier doesn't pay tax to the government. Now friends, when the supplier doesn't pay tax to the government, am I eligible for credit? Strictly speaking, by 36 sub rule 4, the supplier has filed his GSTR1. It has appeared in my GSTR2A. And I have complied with 36 sub rule 4. I have taken the credit, but my supplier has not paid the taxes. Now, just because my supplier has not paid the taxes, I am a genuine person. Still, can the proper officer block my electronic credit ledger? The answer is yes, because now it tells you whether it is fraudulent or it is ineligible. If the tax charged in respect of which has not been paid to the government, my credit is not fraudulent. Of course, yes, by section 16, it becomes ineligible because my supplier has not paid the taxes. Strictly speaking, by 36 sub rule 4, I am still entitled for the credit, but government makes a backdoor entry in 86A. In rule 86A, the government makes a backdoor entry and it is in a way overriding the provisions of 36 sub rule 4. The government tells that the proper officer has got the power that this credit is ineligible. The supplier has not paid the taxes to the government. I can block the credit. So friends, to this extent, this provision seems to be little harsh. The next one, the registered person availing the credit of input tax has been found non-existent or not to be conducting any business from any place for which registration has been obtained. Friends, here the earlier point which we had seen was that the supplier was not existent or the supplier was not conducting any place from the registered place of business or the said registered place of business. Now this is talking about the recipient. The person who is availing the credit is non-existent or is not carrying out any business from the said registered place of business. Point number D, the registered person who is availing any credit of input tax is not in possession of a tax invoice or debit note or any other document which is prescribed under rule number 36. So friends, the person, if he is not having any document based on which he has taken the credit. The first case, Mr. A, what we had seen, he just creates dummy credit. He doesn't have any invoice. So that person would get covered over here. Now both these cases are fraudulent credits. Now friends, this is a fraudulent credit and this also happens to be a fraudulent credit. Now friends, if these reasons are available, if these reasons are the proper officer has got reasons to believe, the proper officer has got reasons to believe that as regards as this input tax credit of a registered person is concerned, it is either ineligible or it is fraudulent for the reason that either the supplier is non-existent or the supplier is not carrying out any business from the said place of business. The recipient is non-existent. The recipient is not carrying out any business from the said place of business. The goods are received without an invoice. There is only an invoice available without the cover of goods if these reasons are available. Or if the supplier has not paid the taxes to the government or if the document is missing. If these reasons are available, what could the officer do? The officer may, for reasons to be recorded in writing, not allow debit of an amount equivalent to such credit. What do you mean by such credit? To that credit which was fraudulent or which was ineligible. The officer may, for the reasons to be recorded in writing, he may not allow debit of an amount equivalent to such credit in the electronic credit ledger for discharge of any liability or for claim of any refund. So friends, let's suppose in the electronic credit ledger, a person is having 1 crore rupees worth credit and the proper officer has got reasons to believe that 80 lakh rupees of this 1 crore is either ineligible or it is fraudulent for the reasons what we have discussed. So now friends, this officer, for reasons to be recorded in writing, he will not allow the debit of that amount. He will not allow the debit of 80 lakh rupees in his electronic credit ledger. This 80 lakh rupees would be blocked. Friends, please understand, it is not a blocked credit under 17 subsection 5. The officer has blocked it from being utilized further for discharging any liability or for application of a refund. The next one, till what point of time is this credit going to be blocked? The officer, now please understand friends, was any notice required to be given to a registered person to block the credit? The answer is no. The crux lies over here. Since the officers were falling short of time, whatever time which was there in show cause notice, representations, order, till such time these people either vanished or they played further game with the government. So now friends, in order to buy time, the government has come out with 86 sub rule 86A, wherein they say that even without any notice, the officer, if he's got reasons to believe, he would record those reasons in writing and straight away he would block the electronic credit ledger. The commissioner or an officer who is authorized by him under subrule 1 may, upon being satisfied that the condition for disallowing debit of electronic credit ledger as above no longer exists. Now friends, please understand, here the government has got, the officer has got only reasons to believe that this credit is ineligible or it is fraudulent. It could be a case that the case is genuine. Initially, the officer has got reasons to believe that it was fraudulent or ineligible, but when the officer further investigated it, he found out that this credit is genuine, it is eligible, it is not ineligible or it is not fraudulent. So at that point of time, he has to lift the credit which is being blocked. So the commissioner or any officer who is authorized by him under subrule 1 may, upon being satisfied that the conditions for disallowing the debit of electronic credit ledger as above no longer exist, he will allow such debit. That means whatever credit ledger which was blocked, he would lift the blockage. Such restriction shall cease to have effect after the expiry of a period of 1 year from the date of imposing such restriction. So friends, the maximum time during which this credit could be blocked is 1 year. Within a period of 1 year, the officer has to carry out the investigation. The officer has to carry out the investigation. Now friends, how would this blocked credit result into? Let's suppose the officer has got reasons to believe. The officer has got reasons to believe that this credit is either ineligible or it is fraudulent. The officer blocked the credit. The moment the credit is blocked, is the work of the officer over? The answer is no. He is going to investigate who are all the people who is involved in the chain, whether this credit is actually fraud or it is genuine. Now, after investigation is over, this blocked credit could result in two ways. One, it could be released. If the officer finds out that this credit is genuine, that blockage is being lifted, the registered person would be allowed to debit his electronic credit ledger after this blockage is being released by the officer. This would happen when the case is genuine. If the case is fraudulent, now the officer would give him show cause notice. The officer has investigated, he has got all material evidence with him, he would give a show cause notice. Principles of natural justice, that means representations and demand order, and then that amount would stand recovered from the registered person who has fraudulently availed the credit. This recovery would be of tax, that is input tax credit, interest, penalty, and maybe he may also be put behind the bars. So this credit which is blocked could result into two ways. Either it could be released if the credit is genuine, which is based on investigation which is being carried out, or it could result into show cause notice, demand order, and then recovery. However, the time limit which an officer has got to carry out this investigation is 1 year from the date of blockage. So within a period of 1 year, either he has to release the credit or automatically it would get released, or he had to proceed to recover the amount from that registered person. Now friends, this completes your 86 sub rule. Just finer points to discuss. Is rule 86A blocking the credit, is it like 17 subsection 5? The answer is no, it is not like 17 subsection 5. The officer is not recovering your credit. The officer is just blocking it from electronic credit ledger being debited. Is it asking you to reverse the input tax credit? The answer is again no. Under 86A, the officer is also not reversing your credit or asking you to reverse the credit. He is just blocking it from it being utilized. Is it fair? Now friends, looking at the frauds which are happening, the government has got no other choice but to come out with this provision. But however, in this provision, there could be certain genuine assessees also who could face this hardship, because this provision is very draconian, wherein in one point it tells you that if the supplier has not paid the taxes also, it becomes ineligible credit and the officer has got the powers to block that credit. Now friends, this in a way is overriding 36 sub rule 4. 36 sub rule 4 tells you that if a credit is appearing in your GSTR 2A, 110% of that you can avail it. That is what 36 sub rule 4 tells you. You need not go and sit and check that whether your supplier has paid the taxes or not. But the government silently makes a backdoor entry wherein it tells that even if the supplier has not paid the taxes, even you would have followed 36 sub rule 4, it appears in your GSTR 2A, supplier has not filed his GSTR 3B, has filed only his GSTR 1. But still the government makes a backdoor entry in 86A, and the government can block the credit even of a genuine person just because his supplier has not paid the taxes. That particular registered recipient would have received the goods, received the invoices, paid the full value of tax, full value of invoice to his supplier. His supplier would have filed GSTR 1, but the supplier did not pay the taxes. He did not file his GSTR 3B. Now in this case, this recipient's credit also can be blocked by using 86A. To that extent, it is a harsh provision. Now friends, it is a harsh provision, but effectively the government should use it only in fraudulent cases, that is in bill traders, and it should not be used for meeting targets. That means the government should follow an ethical manner and just to meet the targets. What do you mean by meeting the targets? Let's suppose the government is falling short of cash. So the government finds out certain registered persons, uses this provision, because this provision doesn't even require a notice. One day you wake up and you say that your electronic credit ledger is blocked. So now friends, just to meet out the targets, and when your electronic credit ledger is blocked, you have to file your GSTR 3B, you have to furnish your returns. So naturally, you'll be using your electronic cash ledger to discharge your liabilities. Now the government's revenue is increased. Just to meet out the targets, the government shouldn't use this 86 capital A. Otherwise, yes, this provision was required because of the number of fraudulent cases which are happening in input tax credit.
Subscribe to LearnCab and hit the bell icon to get notified.